Good afternoon. Thank you for attending our study session this afternoon on capital facilities funding process. Howard is going to introduce this topic to us and discuss it with us. Over here we have, we're being recorded here so that people can see this study session on channel 199 on Charter. And you can also watch this on the PSD YouTube page.
All right, thank you. Good afternoon, Board President Lehrman, Deputy Superintendent Whitney, and members of the board. Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you a little bit today about funding for capital facilities. Of a necessity, this is going to be a high-level view of funding, and the reason for this is there's a lot of ground to cover. I'm going to start out big and then get a little more specific. We'll start out about talking about the entire universe of funding for school districts, and then speak specifically about funding sources for capital facilities. And within this, we'll spend most of the time talking about bonds and school construction assistance program. To help with the presentation on bonds, I'm going to turn things over to our expert here, Mr. Trevor Carlson. He's a managing director, Piper Jaffray, and has worked with the district for many years in bond issue planning, helping us to present our bonds in the most favorable light to the bond investment community. His firm also helps us stay compliant with continuing disclosure requirements that extend over the life of the bond and identifies opportunities for us to refinance. I think most of you may have met Mr. Carlson in that connection about a little over a year ago when we did a refinance. Trevor works out of Seattle, so I want to extend my appreciation for you taking the trip over. Okay, starting at the big level. Most of you have heard this before, but in Washington State, districts are required to separate the resources they receive into five different barrels, funds we call them, for budgeting, accounting, and reporting purposes. Districts receive money from local, state, and federal sources. The use of separate funds enables the legislature, the federal government, and the local taxpayers to see that the money was spent according to its intended purpose. Shown on this sheet are the five funds used in Washington school districts. So by process of elimination, I'm going to show you the sources and required uses for each fund, and we'll get down to the capital facilities funding. So first, at the bottom on the left-hand side for you, transportation vehicle fund in the orange, it's pretty self-explanatory. The money there comes from a state funding allocation, and occasionally on transfers in from the general fund. And it must be, those funds are required to be used for basically purchasing buses. So again, not capital facilities money, not eligible to help there. Second, right next to that, we have the Associated Student Body which most of you are well aware of, is primarily raises money through fundraisers and collection of fees for extracurricular activities. Those ASB dollars must be used for cultural, athletic, recreation, or social activities for the students. Again, not a source for capital projects. Up to the right, the far left, the purple is the debt service fund. And this really is like a clearinghouse, this fund. It accumulates the resources for and payment of long-term debt, principal and interest on our outstanding bonds. So indirectly, it's related to capital projects, but it's just handling the debt service. I think of kind of an escrow fund, that sort of thing. Then finally, on the far right there in red is the general fund, and we've talked about this before. This is the major fund for most districts. It gets its funding from the state allocation, grants, levy, and levy equalization, and it's used for the current, normal, and recurring operations of the school district. All the salaries for school district employees flow through there. And it's unique in its flexibility, as it's the one fund that can really transfer money to the other ones. And generally, that money is transferred, as I mentioned before, to the Transportation Vehicle Fund on occasion, also to the Capital Projects Fund for priority items the board has identified through the budget or through another formal process. So we took all the colors out. The one fund that really accounts for capital facilities is the Capital Projects Fund. Capital Projects Fund must be used for the acquisition or construction of major capital facilities. It can be used for acquisition of land or existing facilities, can be used for the purchase of equipment, can be used for implementing technology systems, improvements to buildings and or grounds, and then there are a number of other items. But again, all of these things need to run through, the expenditures need to run through by the state accounting guidelines through the Capital Projects Fund. So their long-lived capital improvements are paid from here. So within the Capital Projects Fund, it's a little interesting, to say the least, because what happens is you have a number of different sources of revenue that flow into the Capital Projects Fund. Each has a slight difference in what it can be used for. And this is where things get a little tricky. I put four walls there because really it's our challenge is to keep those different types of revenue separate from each other and use them for only their intended purposes. So if you get it, it's like a fund within a fund in some ways. So for example, bond proceeds that you issue, that you have a successful bond issue, the bond revenue is restricted to those projects that were authorized in the bond resolution and were in the ballot titled that the voters approved. That's it. I mean, you can go through a formal process to change that, but by and large, that's what you're required to spend those dollars on. School construction assistance. This needs to be spent on new construction for unhoused students or modernization or replacement of existing areas. Impact and mitigation fees. Those are restricted, as you'll hear later tonight, again, to growth projects as specified in the capital facilities plan. And then we have transfers, again, from the general fund and interest and others. Those are the major sources. And again, they do require some walls to be built around those to make sure we're spending the money, again, in accordance to the law. Trevor's going to talk extensively about bonds, but I'm going to go ahead and skip ahead to the School Construction Assistance Program, also known as SCAP or State Match, sometimes just Match. School construction, as you can imagine, requires a joint effort between the state and local community. And the Construction Assistance Program is the main program, state program, for which this effort at coordination takes place. And it's actually been around since 1947. And its purpose is to accommodate districts experiencing student population growth, renovate or replace aging schools, or improve the built environment to create safe and comfortable learning spaces. For new construction, there are two requirements: demonstrated need for space and demonstrated local financial support. The state wants to see that the community is vested in the project before they're going to contribute state matching dollars. So this is an assistance program, so there are costs the local community needs to pick up. Local funds are typically provided through a bond issue, and the state will want to see those bond issues available and actually spent on projects before they're going to release the state construction assistance dollars. And finally, the important thing about this particular program, there is an effort to equalize assistance, that is, to provide more assistance for those less wealthy districts, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. It's important to be aware of some of the key features of the School Construction Assistance Program. First of all, what can it be used for and what can't it be used for? Basically, the assistance is intended for instructional space. So it can't be used for district administrative space. It actually can't be used for land purchases. Of course, not maintenance and operations. There's a partial list here, but you can see things like utility connections and some of the A&E firms over a certain dollar amount. Even sales tax, and this surprises some folks, but we're not exempt from Washington State sales tax. We pay like everybody else. And a portion of that is covered by this program, but not the entire amount. And it can be significant. In Chihuahua's case, we had over $6 million in sales tax, just to give you an idea. Okay, so we talked about ineligible costs. If there are eligible costs, how does that work through the system? I've got an example, the school construction assistance formula here. And the amount of new construction formula funding the state will approve for a project is determined by these three components. First of all, eligible area. That's the square footage of instructional space for which the state is going to provide funding assistance. You take the number of unhoused students, which we've talked about before, and multiply that by what's known as the student space allocation. And this is a number of square feet per student that the state establishes. Now, it's key to know that the state establishes this. This is a funding mechanism. It may not satisfy what our educational programs require. So that piece is, that's the first piece of it. You get the eligible area. And by the way, I have an example down below of Curie Elementary for the construction portion of that project, so you can see how this works. Then the second factor is the construction cost allocation. This is the state's recognized cost per square foot of new construction. Again, this is a funding mechanism. It is not, it's assigned by the legislature. It's not to be confused with the actual cost per square foot. And then finally, those two funding mechanisms are multiplied by the equalizing factor I talked about, which is the funding assistance percentage. The minimum percentage is 20%, the maximum is 100%, again, of eligible recognized costs. It is calculated annually based on the district's assessed land value per student. We talked about assessed value per student as being kind of a wealth measurement. This is what where they use that. Because Pasco has a relatively low assessed value to student ratio, the district has a higher funding assistance percentage. And that's a good news for the taxpayers, because that means more state assistance per each local dollar raised. So it's important to note, though, that that funding assistance percentage is applied to the prior two funding mechanisms. Again, it's not to the actual cost of the project, which will contain some ineligible costs, etc. So in the example of Curie, you can see across here, if you do the math across, you will get that we received about $12 million for construction for Curie. Now, because we had other costs that weren't eligible for this program, the total actual cost for the project was $18.9 million, and that works out to be a ratio of about 63%, much less than the funding assistance that you're going to see here at 81.76. It's just important to realize that when we talk about an 81.76 match, it doesn't mean, you know, we're going to get all but 18% paid by the state. We've got other ineligible costs and things that we need to procure to help a school run. Okay.
Can I get a little clarification there?
Yeah.
So all of Curie, all together with the state match and everything, cost $18 million, or we put out $18 million, the state put out $11 million?
The construction portion of Curie. Now, I don't have equipment and a lot of other things here. I'm just doing the construction. The total project cost that we spent was $18
million. Okay.
Yeah. And the state funding was about $11 million. That's about your 63%. And I say it's only 63%, but, you know, any time that you can build a building with only one third of the total dollars, out of your pocket. That's
Mr. Roberts.
So we only spent $9 million building Curie?
No, this is construction. This is only construction. There are other dollars that we spent. I used construction.
Okay, just with the construction, we spent $9 million. The state spent $11 million. Just with the construction.
The figures that I have, yes.
Okay, and so then you add the land costs, the equipment costs on top of that.
Whatever the other costs and things above allowances that they give us for furniture and equipment, that type of thing.
Okay.
Okay, so we talked a little bit about eligible costs and then the formula. If I haven't lost you yet, this may do it. This is the timing for state construction assistance, or school construction assistance. Okay. I'm just going to mention some dates here, or months here. July, and just keep that in mind. Mid-July is typically when the state will release construction assistance dollars, but it is only released to those approved projects. You know, we have the D form, we talk about that a lot. Those approved projects that have the local share of funding already in place as of January 31st of that same year. Okay, so February is a time that typically districts issue bonds or do a bond election. So most local funding is from bond proceeds, which are usually not available until after that January 31st deadline, because the elections are in February. So that means in a typical scenario, you pass a bond in February of 1 year, and you can't bid, construct, or access state funding until its release in January of the following year. So it's more than a year under that scenario. And as you can imagine, in some cases, a district will not want to wait that long to begin the first project. So there is a way to do this, and it's called front funding. If you want to expedite the construction and avoid an inflation in the building costs, a district can front fund a project, basically pay for it with its own money up front, and then get reimbursement from the state the following July when it's available. The major criteria here for the state to release those dollars is it wants to see that the district can actually complete that building with its own funding, with its own funding resources only. So the district must be able to show it can fund the entire project, not just its share, but the state share as well. Front funding is designed to help districts get start earlier on projects. And I've only talked about the funding portion of this. Of course, you got to have the ability to construct the building according to this expedited timeline. And that means design work done in advance, really tight planning and execution, but it can be done. As a matter of fact, Franklin Elementary was a front-funded project in our last group. Front-funded or not, another important thing to realize is, as I said before, you have to spend the local dollars before the state is going to chip in on any building. Okay. So that's a thumbnail sketch of the School Construction Assistance Program. As you can imagine, it's in a book about like this thick, and there's a lot more to it. But I just wanted to emphasize some of the few of the components to make the point that this is where our capital projects group, their expertise comes into hand, because they make every effort through the structure, again, through the timing and the sequencing of these projects to maximize that state revenue and on the same time then minimize the local taxpayer-supported piece of things. And speaking of local taxpayer supported, I'm going to turn things over to Trevor here to talk about bonds.
Great. Thank you very much, Howard. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here tonight. I do want to keep this an open dialogue. So if there are questions, right, we're here to make sure you are crystal clear on the concepts that are put forward to you tonight. So with that, let's dive into bond planning. And I pushed the wrong button already. There we go. The slide before you on slide 11 shows some election dates, resolution filing dates, and approximate ballot mailing dates. Let's focus and go from left to right. Election dates, November 2016, November 8th. February of 17 would be Valentine's Day, the 14th. If you chose to go to that special election in April, it would be on the 25th. Do note the resolution filing dates are well in advance of those actual election dates when the ballots are due. So based on your planning cycle, the graphic on the bottom kind of gives you, you know, just a very general representation of kind of backing up from the election, file the election resolution with the county auditor's office. Before that, draft that election resolution, select that date, and in conjunction with your capital project team, your financing team will be working hand in hand to bring ideas to the table. Okay. Just for your reference on page 12, the district's bond election results are highlighted there going back to 1991. The most recent success was in February of 2013 for $46,864,000, which passed at 61.7%. April fell a little short of the supermajority 60% needed to pass, and the rest of the history is there for your review. Let's talk some specifics about the bond financing. There are a number of players involved in executing a bond financing. architect, construction-type folks are going to help you determine the cost and of the scope of the projects that you're looking to tackle. And there'll be some more discussion of those type of line items later on in your board agenda and your regular meeting. As Howard mentioned, OSPI provides your estimate for state matching funds, that D form process. Again, that Howard mentioned, those forms that go back and forth between you and OSPI in determining your eligibility. The next two bullet points are specific financial folks that are going to help you determine the structure of the bond financing, look at its marketability in the marketplace, rating, things of that nature that I'll discuss in just a couple moments. Bond counsel is a specific legal firm that will help you draft, for example, the election resolution and bond resolutions and things of that nature as you go through this process. And the Franklin County Treasurer acts as your ex officio treasurer there. They really handle your cash management function. Some of those buckets that Howard mentioned, I think on his first slide, like debt service, capital projects fund, things of that nature. Those dollars are held at the county. Things that will need to be detailed out on the election resolution are on the right-hand slide, right-hand side of that slide. So the maximum amount to be borrowed, the term of the bonds, typically school bonds are repaid over a 20-year amortization cycle. We can talk about pros and cons of elongating that or shortening that if you so desire. Our goal is to match the useful life of the facilities, at least approximate. What the bond proceeds are going to be used for needs to be in that election resolution, and the use of state matching money. And last but not least, the district will have unlimited authority to collect sufficient taxes, regardless of rate or amount, to pay off the bonds, to pay the debt service. And what that really means is based on the composition of your district's assessed value. Think of a small district that is a one mill town. If that mill goes bankrupt and goes away, the residents are still obligated to make those debt service payments. So depending on how the composition of your tax base shifts around, you're still able to collect the property taxes to service those debt payments. That's what that means. Okay. Let's talk about some specifics on a couple of different tools that school districts utilize to borrow for capital projects, and we'll look at statutory debt capacity. So as you most likely know, bonds are the primary method for school districts to borrow very large sums of money to construct very long-lived capital assets like new elementary schools and middle schools and the like. The couple reasons why, as Howard mentioned, those funds are generated up front, so you have those in the bank to go forth and build, right? Construction inflation is something to be aware of, and having those dollars in the bank sooner than later is important. Those payments can be structured there's a lot of flexibility in how you can structure those bond payments. So we can tackle things like keeping your tax rate level over time, okay? State law gives us a lot of flexibility there. To control taxpayer impacts. So for your voter-approved unlimited tax general obligation bonds, the debt capacity calculation is in the RCWs. It's 5% of your assessed value. So the box on the right, lower right-hand side gives an example of what your 2016 total debt capacity looks like. So your assessed value is $5.1 billion. 5% of that number is $257,000. Then we take away the debt that's outstanding on your books today from a voted and non-voted perspective, add in any dollars in your debt service fund, leads us to $116 million and change. That is the maximum amount of bonds you could issue in calendar year 2016. So every year, this calculation changes slightly. For you, your assessed value, and Howard will detail that after my section, has increased very steadily over time. So that it's an important input. And as you pay down principal of your debt, that debt capacity usually grows over time. Okay. Unlimited tax general obligation bonds are repaid with property taxes, so it creates a new revenue stream opposed to non-voted debt, and I'll describe some details on the next slide there. You do need 60% yes vote at the ballot, 60% approval, with 40% validation. So your levies, like your capital levy, transportation, maintenance, and operation, are 50 plus one, no validation hurdle. So that's the difference there. Any questions on voter approved before we move to non-voted?
What's validation?
40% of the 40% of the voters that voted at the last general election need to come out and vote. So you need to have a sizable number for a turnout. That hasn't been a problem in decades, especially since mail-in ballots. We haven't had a school district achieve over 60% and not hit the validation. Non-voted or limited general obligation bonds are bonds that you could think of as a personal loan backed by the general fund of the school district. Okay, so your general fund would have to make those payments. There is not a new revenue stream created. The debt capacity calculation is very similar, but the threshold is much less. It's only 3/8 of 1% of your total assessed value, where the voted is 5%. Going through the math, 5.1 billion times 3/8 of 1% equals 19 million. Take away what you have on the books today, leaves you about $19 million of capacity. Capital projects levies are another tool that a school district could utilize to tackle projects and pay for them. It's just like your maintenance and operation levy. You're going to ask the voters for a collection amount on a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 year cycle. And those dollars will come in on that cycle just like your maintenance and operation levy. So you can probably think of the downside of trying to tackle multi-million dollar school construction projects with a capital projects levy. You're going to have very large collections for a very short amount of time. So think of a 15-year mortgage versus a 30-year mortgage. You're going to have very high tax rates because you're going to have to collect a lot of money up front. There's also, you know, kind of esoterically, some equity issues. If you were able to tackle those projects with a capital projects levy, the folks that are living here today are paying for those projects. Folks that moved in maybe in year 7, 8, 9, 10 would be able to utilize those nice facilities and not have to pay for them. But the biggest issue is your tax rate would be exceedingly high because those collections would have to be high. The other issue would be cash flow. So with the bond issue, you're garnering that construction dollars in the bank very quickly. Again, with a capital projects levy, let's say it's 1/6 of your total dollar amount is going to come in on an annual basis. So you could have some construction cash flow mismatches between your revenue and your actual expenditures. But the big positive is simple majority, 50% plus one needed to pass this. Any questions on those different tools? Okay. So what I think about on a day-to-day basis are the bullet points on page 16. So what are your costs of your projects? And then how are we going to pay for those costs? So revenue, bonds, state match, investment earnings, impact fees. Let's look at all these different revenue streams that are coming into your district to compensate for the projects that are on the docket. The other important piece would be timing. Cash flow timing is key. I need to make sure that I'm depositing bond proceeds in your account in sufficient dollar amounts at the right time so construction folks have cash in the bank to go build and bid projects. There's also tax law considerations that are in the back of our mind as we're moving through time. Won't get into too much detail there, but the tax-exempt bonds have IRS requirements attached to them. We want to make sure we're checking off those boxes and doing things appropriate on that front. So taxpayer impact, the way we can communicate the cost of the bond to the taxpayer. Tax rates are primarily the standard means of communicating that cost. Everybody has a different value to their property, to their home, to their real estate, to their land, and to be able to have one number that you can apply to your value has proven to be a very useful tool as you move forward during the election process. So I want to talk about some of the assumptions that go into the planning, interest rates, bond rating, bond structure, assessed value. As I mentioned, I'll stop, and when Howard takes over, he'll talk about assessed value and what's happened in the recent past. So interest rates. A bond, think of it as a big loan. The only difference is with a bond issue, we take that loan and we slice into a lot of different pieces, and we find a lot of different investors to buy those pieces. Borrowing cost is paramount, drives obviously the cost of that big loan to the district and thus tax rates. The graphic on the bottom is a representative tax-exempt borrowing index or borrowing cost. As you can see, we've bounced around a little bit over the last couple of years as there's been volatility in the marketplace for one reason or another. But we're bouncing along the bottom of all-time lows. We're bouncing, and borrowing costs are very, very low. The one-year snapshot just kind of blows that up to show you what's happened over the last 12 months. And really, since the beginning of this year, as the equity markets have experienced a lot of volatility, there have been kind of a flight to safety, a flight to quality, if you will, of folks moving dollars into safe fixed income assets like school district bonds, thus driving the borrowing cost very, very low. Okay, so we're going to include that assumption, some contingency, because you do not lock in your borrowing costs until you actually sell the bonds. So again, think of my first slide with that timeline. You're starting here with an election, and you're backing up, and we're doing a lot of planning. We have to build in some contingency with the plan that you're going to lock in at time X. When you actually go get the election at time X plus something, and then you actually sell the bonds even later. So, right, we want to build in some contingency, just like your construction folks are. Bond rating, I've got a couple slides here, and I don't want to get into too much detail, but I want to have these here just in case there were some questions that came up. The school district has a very strong credit rating, an underlying credit rating with Moody's. And I was here about a year ago when we did the bond refinancing, secured and reaffirmed that AA3 credit rating. The state also provides a credit enhancement tool, which is the next bullet point down, called State Guarantee, which means the state's a co-signer. And if for any reason the Pasco School District was unable to make its bond payments, the state would step in. Thus, you can utilize the state's credit rating when you're marketing the bonds, which is one notch below AAA. So the combination of those two data points creates a very strong market for your bonds when you come to market. The other important considerations would be financial performance, so general fund balance, local economic factors, population, enrollment growth, assessed value, growth rates, things of that nature. Debt factors, how much debt is on the books. The rating agencies will look at different ratios comparing that dollar amount to your total population, for example. So different ways to measure the debt burden of the district's residents. And then governmental factors, kind of a catch-all, but the biggest thing that comes into play there are you able to get your maintenance and operation levies passed on a consistent basis, because they're a big portion of your revenue as you go forward. The graphic there kind of shows the four main general areas that the credit rating agencies are looking at. These are bullet points from the Moody's report from January of 2015. Want to highlight the credit strengths of the district. So moderately sized tax base that grew through the recession. That was a very rare occurrence. If I look at a chart of just about every other school district in the state, their assessed values went negative during the Great Recessions. Yours did not. Very large credit positive, growing student enrollment, and multiple years of positive financial results with leading to a healthy general fund reserve balance. The concerns, and these are quotes, you know, direct bullet points from the Moody's report that was published last year, socioeconomic measures, and the high level of direct debt and adjusted net pension liability. So they've brought pensions into the mix in the last couple of years. It's obviously really something you do not have control over. It's all handled at the state's level. So again, very strong credit rating. These are wonderful bullet points. Just for your reference, page 22, you have a series of bonds that are outstanding going back to 2004. There's the 06s, 07s. We just refinanced the 07s last year. The 10s, the 12s, the 13s, and the 2015s. One thing I want you to think about is the final maturity column, second in from the right, has bonds that are expiring over time. The thought process has been for many, many years and during multiple election cycles is to try and maintain tax stability with the district's residents. And the way that we've tried to accomplish that is to try and maintain a tax rate that's approximately level over time. So as these bonds are falling off, really what's happening is we are having a pattern where the next bond issue came online and we were backfilling, right? We're trying to keep a pattern that was consistent. So we're not seeing, because of those bond issues falling off, we're not seeing tax rate decrease. The grand plan, if you will, had tax rate being consistent over time. So those next bond issues being layered on to try and create a pattern that would look like this. So really the large debt payments fall off in 2028. There's a small piece that's hanging out there in 2029, okay? Does that make sense? We're not having decreasing dollar amounts, right? Your total debt service payments over time are slightly, are growing about at a 3% clip, because that's the kind of the assessed value growth rate that we've put into our model over the years. Okay, any questions before I turn it over to Howard to talk a little bit about tax rate and assessed value? And I'm not going anywhere, so if you have something that comes up, give me a holler. Thank you.
Okay, so this is an important formula, and to get a handle on this, and if it looks familiar, it should, because the top number above the bar now says amount of debt service. We just talked about levy. That used to say amount of levy. It's the same formula. You divide that by the total assessed value of the taxing district. That's the value of all the real and personal property in the area served by Pasco School District. And if you look at that formula, you could see that there's a couple different ways you could influence the tax rate. One is above the line, above the bar, you could do something with the amount of debt service, either decrease it or increase it, and you're gonna increase or decrease the tax rate, obviously. The other thing you could do is below the bar, and if you were able to increase the assessed value, you're basically spreading that debt among more participants, if you will, and that's another way of influencing the debt service. And what I'd like to do is just kind of show you real quickly how this works, and I think some of you have seen this before. I wanted to give you some pictures, just because for me it makes more sense this way. So the basic premise of these is that we have a community. There are three identical houses. They're all worth $100,000. And this particular community has a levy or has a bond outstanding, and the principal and interest due on that bond for that year is even $1,000. Again, we're going to make this easy. So you have a total of $300,000, three times a $100,000 house is in assessed value. And you divide that by the rate, the debt that needs to be raised, the debt service amount that needs to be paid, and you're going to get a very small number, 0.00333. This is why typically when you talk about tax rates, you talk about per thousand of assessed value. It just makes more sense. We're going to move that decimal point over three to the right, and you hear something more common. This is $3.33 per thousand of assessed value. If you apply that $3.33 to each of those 100 houses, you can see that each of them are going to pay $333.33. Someone's going to have to chip in another penny to pay the entire $1,000, but that basically gets you to that point. So that's the base community. What happens if you were to add another house, which never happens here in Pasco? And all of a sudden, it's exactly the same again, $100,000. Now you've got four times $100,000, you've got $400,000. Again, your assessed value base has grown. You still need the same $1,000, but instead of paying $333 each, because it's you've got four houses, they're all going to contribute $250. Very simple example, but just to kind of show you that idea. And then I went one step further when I did this for the facilities task force. So let's add commercial, because commercial can add a chunk of things. And it, this, again, is very hypothetical. But we're going back to the original three-house community. And now we're going to add a business that's got a property and equipment value of $1.7 million. So the top number in the equation is still that same $1,000 that's due. The bottom number is dramatically larger. It's now $2 million. So the new rate is 1,000 divided by 2 million, or 0.0005. You move that over three places, and you've got 50 cents per 1,000 of assessed value. And the way it works out for the taxpayers depends on their assessed value. And you can see the homes with less value are going to pay a lot less. And because the business or the commercial is going to pay $850 again because of the large assessed value. So this is why it's good news, obviously, when we have a firm like AutoZone saying, hey, we're interested in coming into the Tri-Cities. So the point of those illustrations was to show that the impact of new construction on school finances isn't like with the city, where right away you can start counting additional sales tax from a new business. But that's not what our revenue base is. Our revenue base is on property tax. And so to clear up a common misconception, new construction does not mean an immediate infusion of new tax dollars for the district. The taxes the district collects for the year are fixed, as I mentioned there. They've already been set. What does happen is new construction adds to the assessed value, allowing that debt service to be spread over more taxpayers, which, if all other things remain equal, are going to reduce the tax rates for all the taxpayers. Does that make sense? Any questions about that?
Yeah, I just had a quick question about how do like large apartment complexes play into this? Does that value, that property value, also assess, and the owner of that would also pay a large amount?
Yes, it depends on what the assessed value is, correct. Okay, as Trevor mentioned, here's a little bit of the assessed value. And you can see the changes over the year, pretty steady increase. Over the last 10 years, it's been about 6.7% compounded. Over the last 5 years, it's slowed down some, but we're still right around 4% a year. And I will mention that the commercial portion of this has been rising. It's slowly, but it's been there. Over the past 3 years when I've asked for this, it's grown from about 20% of the tax base up to about 25% the last time I asked for that. So it is growing. And you can see our assessed value, it finally topped the $5 billion mark in 2016. So just to see the numbers, how it actually looks in 2016, here's the calculation. And instead of $1,000 that are due, we do have about $12.2 million, almost $12.3 million due in principal and interest for 2016. Divide that by the assessed value, move the decimal points over three, and you get our current bond rate. Again, it's our bond tax rate at $2.39 per $1,000 of assessed value. Way back in 2012, when I gave a presentation similar to this and we were trying to plan for the 2013 bond, we had to, of course, look forward and add the debt onto the structure and try to estimate what the tax rates would be. And we had estimated at that point that this year in 2016, the rate would be $2.59. We're about 20 cents shy of that, couple reasons. One is we're going to be a little conservative, again, in the assessed value, and Pasco continues to grow in that regard. The other thing is we were able to refinance some dollars, able to take some interest, get a reduced interest rate on some of our debt, and drop that outstanding debt. So that's good news. Because we've been just talking about the bond tax rate, I wanted to show you a graph that shows the combined property tax rate for Pasco School District. And this has the levy in blue and the bond in red. You can see how it's appeared over the years. It's totaling about $6.71 between the two in 2016. And finally, I talked about, we've talked a lot about things that can influence the rate for the taxpayer, and that's even things like interest rates, bond ratings, and all that type of thing. But by the time it gets to you and I as a property owner, the tax rate can be influenced by other things, not the least other governmental entities besides, in this case, Pasco. This is a snapshot of the current tax property tax rates for Tax District 101, Franklin County. This has the largest number of citizens in it that would attend or in the Pasco School District boundaries, and you can see we're just one of many. The other thing, it's pretty obvious, but we can do all we can with the tax rate to keep it low, but your individual assessed value is going to play a role in that. If it grows faster or less than the average for the community, you'll see that too. And sometimes that can outweigh, no matter how diligent we try to plan for the tax rates. So, thank you very much for the attention. This is, again, a lot of information. Tried to run through school district funding in general, a little bit more specifically about capital facilities funding, and then just give you some context for Pasco. These are a little more text-driven, a lot more text on these slides than I generally like to do, but the reason for that is hopefully this can serve as a reference for you. And if you go along, and because this is a lot of information and you have a chance to think about this and you come up with some questions, first of all, Trevor and I are here and we'll address any that we can here. But if you want to talk more about it, give me a call and I'd be glad to work through it. And if I get over my head, I will talk to Trevor, because this is a very unique field in tax issues and a lot of other things, structuring of bonds or things why we have an expert do that. So with that, I'm going to speak for Trevor and say that we'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, what exactly is Trevor to us?
Trevor would function as the underwriter.
Okay. Does he work for the school district or is he totally separate?
He's an independent company, yes.
I know you said that, but
no, that's fine.
There's a lot to catch right now.
Yeah, he's worked for us on a number of our issues, though, that we've had, yeah.
One of the comments or things you guys mentioned was maintaining the bond rate the same. And I like how you pointed out that as bonds drop off, then there's some amount where we would be able to pass, if we passed another bond, that would maintain that rate about the same. So to me, that's a key number I'd like to know, is if we have one falling off in the next year or two, then what that would dictate to some degree, how much we would be able to seek to try to maintain that. There, I know there's so many factors that go into that, but does that make sense? The falling off bond that we would complete and how we would maintain it, like I said, I know there are a lot of factors that would go into it, and we're somewhat prognosticating in the future, but that slide that you showed, like we're around the 250, yes, right.
Slide 23.
So if we look at that and how you mentioned that the bond from 2004, 2006, as that drops off, then that would allow us to pursue some amount that would maintain that. Does that make sense? So that's what I want to know.
Yes, it does. And as those bonds are being paid off, in the past, we've backfilled and created a pattern. Think of this. You can think of this also as your principal and interest payments over time. They're approximately equal. So instead of dollars per thousand, you could just say this is your annual debt service in each of those years. You have a sizable amount of debt that's already outstanding. For example, if you're going to go to the ballot in 2017 and ask for $80 to $90 million to tackle project X, Y, and Z, that bond tax rate would then hit in 2018, right? You sell bonds in year one, you can't start collecting taxes until the following calendar year. You're gonna see an increase in this bond tax rate pattern of about 50 to 60 cents. At this point in time, you have a sizable amount of debt that's outstanding, that's on the books right now. So any incremental ask at the ballot box will be an increase to the rates that are shown here. And I think what will follow from this is you go through with your capital team and you start to, I think of this as a filter. You've got a bunch of ideas right now. We start chunking through those ideas, and one comes out the bottom. That's the one that goes to the ballot box. My guess is we're going to have a lot of ideas. We're going to have a lot of different financing scenarios attached to those ideas, and I think that will help get your mind around what you want to pursue, if anything, in the future. But you will see a tax rate increase with the next bond, unless you waited until 2028.
Yeah, it would have been interesting to have seen what the 2013 bond did to this rate when we passed our last bond.
What we can do that.
Which
I don't know if I have that on there.
You have the total tax rates, don't you?
Yeah, I do. So you can actually see it a little bit on this, Amy. I can't tell you the exact amount, but
yeah, or you know, this is obviously to scale here, and we can't. I don't know what those exact dollar amounts are that play into those different colors on those bars, but some of that factor, Amy, is assessed value assumptions. You know, we assume 3%. You've seen more than 3%, hence the decrease in the tax rate over the last couple years. So a lot of different factors at play.
Yeah, it doesn't look like it increased as much as I would have expected, right? I mean, are you thinking
it's
the same
thing?
It's
still hard to see because it's the resident
yeah.
looking at the
there's
rent
yes.
level
that much of
on
difference.
The top or the bottom.
Yeah.
So.
And one thing that we can share with you would be the final numbers from the 2013
yeah.
bond sale,
yeah.
Which show our guests at that point in time when we sold the bonds, what that structure that we locked in, what we thought it might produce in tax rates going forward. We can circulate that around.
That'd be great. Thank
yeah.
you.
So from that picture, it kicked in 2014, right?
And yes.
So if you look at the red bar between 2013 and 2014, I'm just estimating here, maybe 50 cents or something like that
yeah,
is
it
what
up
it
on
looks
both
like.
Sides.
A quarter, 50 cents.
You can also see when Chihuahua was issued,
yep.
when we put the bond, you can about see that. If you look way back into 94, 95, we had a couple, that's where if you saw that list, we had a couple bond failures at that point. And so you can see that red piece really dropped. So you can tell a little bit about the history by looking at that thing.
So from a bond structuring strategy perspective, I'm gonna try and jump to that slide again, there we go. What we will most likely try to accomplish is to have minimal principal payments from today through 2028. And then we have some capacity. So think of those bars dropping down or to zero as capacity to start having larger principal payments come due. But there's, you know, I work in a field that's, there's no free lunch, right? You're borrowing money, you've got to pay it back with interest. And there's only so much you can do to push on one side without it poking out on the other, right? There's the kind of a fulcrum point, and it's a teeter-totter. There's pros and cons. And we can walk through very specific examples as you give us feedback on what your capital project list looks like, which then dovetails into dollars, which dovetails into the difference between state match and the local share, aka the bond.
But it does look like it drops in 18-19 on that.
Ever so slightly.
Yeah. Which is
minimal.
So
we'll take it, we'll use it, but it's mm-hmm. There's not a lot of capacity in this structure. And that's been, you know, the way we've tackled this over the years. Yeah, Steve, sorry.
So that's 239, I think, was the number you put up there.
Was today's.
Right.
Yes.
Right. The current.
Is that fixed? I mean, if we don't do anything, is it going to stay at that? Is that based, if our assessed value continues to go up, that will continue to go down?
If assessed value comes in at a number greater than 3% over time, that will be a downward sloping curve, if you will.
So that's based on a 3% assessed value
yes.
increase?
Yes.
All right, so we're 12 and a half years out. It doesn't go past 2029. At 2029, is it zero?
Yes, 2030 is zero.
Okay.
I am 90%, let me make sure. Yes, the second line from the bottom there, 2013, your last payment's December 1st, 2029.
So obviously, I mean, that's in the 230, 240 range there for the next 12 years. And our rate, I mean, if you could go back and just take the blue line out and see what the red is, it's been kind of up and down for 20 plus years. And I'm looking at this and I'm saying, okay, for 12 years, if we don't do anything, this is what we get. I'm curious to know if we went back to 2013 and did this, when that 2013 bond, were we out 12 years? Were we out 15 years? Were we out 8 years on a level? Do you understand what I'm asking?
Yeah, and I can and I think that dovetails into Amy's question. I can show you what our thought was at the date of sale in 2013.
I don't think that's the solution, to just extend our debt further to build schools, but I'm curious to know what we've done in the past, where we've been, how far out we were when we passed a bond. Were we out 12 years like this, or were we out 8, or were we out?
We can show you that detail.
Does anyone utilize the capital projects levy? I mean, do they?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. So, but let's put this in perspective. If you have two elementaries and a middle school and safety and security, and let's say it adds up to $80 million, maybe 90, you're amortizing that, you're not making payments, but you're collecting that dollar amount divided by 6. Your tax rate is going to be much higher than 50 or 60 cents.
Yes.
So that's, it will be, in my opinion, prohibitive to garner voter support.
I know. It just makes a lot more sense. I'd much rather save money for a project than go into debt.
I totally agree. The other, as I mentioned earlier, and maybe I didn't hit this hard enough, is cash flow timing. You're going to not be able to pay for all of those projects for that six, you know, that money's going to, it's like a pay-as-you-go program.
I know.
I understand that. Construction inflation today is problematic. I'm concerned with some school districts that passed bonds last year, let alone the ones that just passed in February. Construction inflation is increasing very rapidly. So that's a point. Then just the cycle of trying to phase in the building of these things over a very slow time period, you know, in the managing of contractors and things like that. Where school districts are able to utilize that tool efficiently, number one is Seattle. Seattle does not borrow, I shouldn't say ever, but basically they use capital project levies for their ongoing construction of schools. Why?
Slightly higher tax base.
Their tax base is I don't know the number, $180 billion. The other way that school districts utilize that tool, again, would be a very large school district like Renton that passed a very large capital projects levy in February. But usually those capital projects levies are tied into ongoing maintenance and technology. The technology levy technically is a capital projects levy. So those are the usual outcomes and uses for those tools. It just becomes cost prohibitive to amortize $90 million over 6 years, opposed to being able to spread the burden over 20.
Which makes sense. I can't go buy a house by saving for 6 years outright. So
right.
How much are we collecting in bond taxes every year?
Right around 12 million. I think Howard's number was close to 12.3.
So I have a couple of thoughts. The commercial development is a big issue, and I've heard that a lot, but this helped explain that more. Because not only does the commercial development add to our assessed value, but if we assume that they, and I wouldn't necessarily assume that, that the, like say this AutoZone hires a lot of people from our community that are either unemployed or underemployed, not only does that add to assessed value, it also doesn't necessarily add a huge number to our student population. And so that becomes extremely beneficial. Whereas if we look at just additional housing, they increase our assessed value slightly, but they may have two or three or four children that suddenly becomes a very difficult strain on our schools that are already overcrowded. So I'd love to see our community somehow you know, work to increase commercial. And I've heard that over the years, it is in struggle. I have another thought, but this.
Okay, I was just gonna mention, this is something I forgot. This is one of the areas where I know Mr. Christensen has been involved in trying to reclaim some property for commercial purposes. The CREATE group that meets, I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's a local source from the school district, the port, the city, Benton PUD, and some other players get involved, and Randy's our representative, I believe, every month, and they talk about this very same thing. You know, how can we, that's one of their focuses, how can we make ourselves attractive for, you know, commercial development? So there's a place where we try to work hand in hand with other governmental entities to do this.
Dr. Richardson, I'm also a member of the Pasco Chamber. I'm a liaison board member there, and the port's there, and they are constantly, they're very aware of the commercial need for us, and they're constantly advocating for that and working on our behalf. So again, some phenomenal partnerships in our community that recognize the need for the additional commercial. So it's also a focus at the Pasco Chamber meetings that I attend.
Great. My other thought had to do with, you know, this was an excellent presentation on the financials, and it really helped give a good understanding of that. But in the end, what's really going to matter is, what is our community, are they going to support a bond, and which projects would they support? To me, that's the big question, right? All the, we could come up with great plans, if we can't get 60% of people that will, that vote to vote yes and support, then that's, nothing matters. All of this doesn't matter. And so in some way, we're going to have to make sure we have input from the community and have some sort of assessment of what does our community want and desire, and what will they support, because that's what it comes down to in the end.
So that leads into a topic we're going to further discuss on the bond issue here this evening, when Mr. Nunnemaker comes in and talks about different options that we have. We're not going to take any action on that tonight, but it's more education for us, more education for the community, and I'll echo what Dr. Richardson said. As we get this education, we're going to have to take it to the public and figure out what the best option is for everyone involved. So.
And we are planning community forums around these issues to see what our community wants and what our community will support, and taking into account the task force that was already formed and their work in what their research showed that we need.
All right, thank you to Mr. Carlson and to Mr. Roberts, and we'll see some of you back here at 6:30 for a regularly scheduled board meeting.